Happy New Year and welcome to Pender United Methodist Church. We're so glad that you found us on New Year's Eve. Tonight we're going to do something special. We're going to be participating in a watch night service. So we're glad that you found us. Let's begin our evening of worship tonight by listening to our opening hymn.
Our first hymn is a song entitled Days of Elijah.
Listen to the word of God as it comes to us this evening from 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 18 and following. Slaves, be submissive to your masters with all respect, not only to the kind and gentle, but also to the overbearing. For one is approved if, mindful of God, he endures pain while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if, when you do wrong, and are beaten for it, you take it patiently. But if when you do right and suffer for it, you take it patiently, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, no guile was found on his lips. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he trusted to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins on his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. This is the word of God for the people of God. Would you please pray with me? Oh God, we live in messy and in scary times. But help us to hear the hope tonight that we might look forward to 2021 and lay the past behind us. All honor and glory is yours, Father Almighty, now and forever. Amen. Well, when my boys were very young, my son Joe was maybe 2 years old, and my son Ben was only 1 year old. My wife Donna would put them down to sleep in the afternoon. And she was doing that one day and had gone downstairs into the parsonage to the living room to do some other work. When she hadn't been there very long, still she heard one of the boys, she heard Joseph actually call out saying, "Mama, Mama, Mama." And so my wife turned around and went back upstairs to the master bedroom where she laid them down. She tried to open the door, and when she put her hand on the knob, she recognized that the door had been locked from the inside. So she used her teacher's voice and called out to my older son, Joe. She said, "Joe, please open the door." There was a long pause, and then my son, Joe, said, "I can't, Mama. There's lotion on it." What he meant was that there was baby lotion on the doorknob. He had put it there. And so my wife explained to Joe in her calm teacher's voice to go find maybe a pair of pants or a shirt or something, a clothing item from our closet, and to put it on the doorknob and to gently turn it. He finally did, and the door was opened. And we found that the baby oil, the baby lotion, was not only on the doorknob, but it was all over the inside of our closet. It was all over the furniture that was there in the bedroom, all over my sleeping son, Benjamin, and all over my son, Joe. It was a very messy situation. This past year has been a very messy situation for most of us. Of course, there's the situation that we have been in with this horrible virus that has taken so many lives. And then, of course, there was a presidential election that was very contentious and pitted people against one another. And then on top of all of that, there was racial unrest and violence. It was a very messy situation in 2020. We're lucky that in God's holy word, these kinds of experiences, they're understood. You see, the author of 1 Peter, presumed to be Simon Peter, the disciple of Jesus, he was addressing a community that was involved in a very messy set of circumstances. It was a messy situation for them too. Domitian was the Roman Caesar, and he had declared himself not only Caesar and king, but God. This, of course, was not acceptable to the early Christians. And not only could they not accept it, they could not find it within themselves to remain quiet, and they spoke out against it. And so Domitian did what so many despots do in a situation like that. He rounded up people and had them arrested. And sadly, he murdered other Christians in the early church. People didn't know what was going to happen next. They were waiting for the next shoe to drop. And it was so bad, in fact, that people were beginning to wonder in the early Christian community whether or not the end was coming, whether it was there. They weren't sure. They thought maybe it was the end of times. The author of 1 Peter doesn't agree with them, but instead provides them with hope and perspective. Hope and perspective in not only a messy situation, but one that was very scary also. Speaking of messy and scary, how about verse 18? It reads, "Slaves, accept the authority of your masters with all deference, not only those who are kind and gentle, but also those who are harsh. Slavery, we know in this country, was one of the most horrible chapters in our history. Something that we try to get over as best we can in this country, but the scars, they're still present with us. Today's passage states that slaves should obey their masters. We read that and we say, how on earth could this be? How could this be? We read in the book of Exodus about God leading the Hebrew people from slavery and captivity to freedom. And in the book of Genesis, we read about someone we're familiar with. His name was Joseph. He was sold into slavery by his brothers. But God in his providence freed him. Freed him and made him a blessing to other people. We know our God stands for justice. God doesn't condone slavery. This passage of scripture could not be some sort of endorsement of slavery. It isn't, in fact. You see, Peter, the disciple of Jesus, presumed to be the author of this text, he was addressing a group of people who actually were slaves. They faced the cruelty of that experience. They were suffering not because they had done anything wrong, but because they were living in a world that was, well, fallen and broken. They were facing a situation that was much bigger than they were and largely outside of their control. Under Domitian, you see, the idea of deliverance was just impossible. Just impossible. It wouldn't come for a long, long time, and justice had been totally and completely distorted. So Peter and the early Christians are very limited in terms of what they can actually do. And yet, as we come to understand that, we understand that about this text, this is where we find hope. Because that abusive situation of slavery isn't being condoned or sanctioned, neither is injustice. Slavery's not being endorsed here. Abuse isn't being endorsed here. Injustice isn't being endorsed here. But what is being endorsed and lifted up is this: endurance. Endurance during hard times. Endurance is approved of in every way in the scripture passage. Endurance is about holding on. Endurance is about continuing when you don't believe that you can. Endurance is about continuing to get up, to try, to reach, and to strive, even though there are many obstacles in front of us. Peter is urging the early Christians, those who are sometimes slaves, to endure. Not because he's suggesting that evil should continue, not because he's suggesting that the situation they're in is one that shouldn't be changed, but rather he's lifting up endurance because endurance is a sign of faith. It's a sign of strength of character. It's a sign of hope. Hope in the Lord. And so Peter says to this group of people who are suffering, not because they've done anything wrong, but because they live in a fallen world, he says to them, their suffering is like that of Jesus. It's the highest compliment that he can offer. Yeah, I hear you asking, but Reverend, where is the hope in all this? Well, the hope in all this is that Jesus is the brother of those who suffer. Those who suffer during this pandemic, those who suffer economically, those who suffer in isolation. Jesus is the brother of those who suffer. Jesus is the brother of those who suffer, not because they have done anything wrong, but because they live in a fallen world and there are circumstances that are bigger than they are and that are beyond their control. And the great news is that the Lord is saying to people like that, saying to you and to me during this time in which so many people are struggling, that you can be a representative of the Lord. Those people who are in suffering, those people who are in pain, the light of Christ can shine in and through them. They too can represent the Lord Christ. And not only that, those who are struggling for whatever reason, they're included and are brought in close as part of the family. That's wonderful news. Because friends, this has been a messy and scary year. There are matters over which we have no control. So when we've done all that we can, and we should do all that we can, that's when Peter's words of comfort are for us as we look back on 2020. So I'd invite you, if you will, to imagine this. Imagine that coming into our sanctuary tonight, imagine that coming into your living room at home this evening is none other than Simon Peter, the fisherman, the disciple of Jesus himself. His hair is tangled and matted. His face is weathered and warm, but his smile and his eyes are full of the love of Christ. And as we watch him come into our midst, one of us comes up with the courage to ask him a question. Simon Peter, isn't the church supposed to oppose evil and alleviate suffering in all times and places? And Peter looks back at us and says, yes. Yes, that's right. But then he scratches his beard and he looks at us with love in his eyes and says, but in those times, when only perspective and hope and camaraderie could be offered, it was offered. And in those times when the only thing that could be offered was brotherhood, sisterhood, and friendship. Brotherhood, sisterhood, and friendship was offered. That's what the followers of Jesus do when times are difficult. And all of us just sit there for a moment and let those words fall upon us and sink in. And then one person, and then another person, and another, and another, and another, and then all of us together say, hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, with all that has happened in 2020 and the desire to put that behind us and to move into 2021, tonight is a wonderful night for us to commit or recommit ourselves to Christ. The early Methodists had a way of doing that. They would gather together on New Year's Eve, like tonight, and celebrate a watch night service, the kind of service we're having this evening. And they would turn and return to God once again. So we're going to do that tonight by offering together a covenant prayer. But before we do, I hope you'll listen to this hymn that is a reminder of the covenant that we make with Christ and that we'll reaffirm tonight. This is a hymn that was written by Charles Wesley.
Closing hymn is "Come Let Us Use the Grace Divine." Come let us use the grace divine and all with one accord in a perpetual covenant join ourselves to Christ the Lord. Give up ourselves through Jesus' power His name to glorify and promise Him this sacred hour. For God to live and die. The covenant we this moment make be ever kept in mind. We will no more our God forsake or cast these words behind.
Wherever you happen to be tonight, I hope you'll join me in praying together the prayer that you should see on your screen at this time. This is the covenant prayer, and I invite you to please pray with me. I am no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what thou wilt. Rank me with whom thou wilt. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed by thee or laid aside for thee, exalted for thee or brought low for thee. Let me be full, let me be empty, let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine, and I am thine. So be it, and the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. I hope you prayed that prayer with us tonight. I hope you'll join us this coming Sunday. We have a special event happening in our worship services at 9 a.m. and 11:15 a.m. on Sunday mornings. I'll be interviewing the three wise men. It should be very exciting. I hope you'll join us. But now let's receive the benediction. And now may this covenant that we have made tonight help us to lay behind us the cares of 2020, and to look forward in hope for 2021. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen.